of the mic high and make a swing.
I have the capability to rap and chill. Coax and tax and seas who tend to act ill. It's like a stick of smack. Smack me and I'll smack your back. I can.
Tali Ndongo, aka Tali Taliwa, aka I am Black Girl.
Mon nom c'est Martin Cholo, je viens du Beyrouth, arrivé ici à 3-4 ans.
My name is Alexis, and I'm definitely from Montreal.
Désuet Plingré, Elmé, MC du groupe depuis déjà une quinzaine d'années.
Moi c'était eux, Désuet Plingré, toujours beatmaker depuis une quinzaine d'années.
Representing Montreal, representing Haiti to the fullest. Been doing this all my life. Never took a break. 24/7, and I'm about to do this all my life.
I'm from Montreal, born and raised. I'm a member of Nomadic Massive. I'm a vocalist and MC. I've been in this group for 12 years. I'm also a community educator. I do workshops on the nonviolent origins of hip hop culture with Maryse Legagneur. The project is called Hip Hop No Pop. And I'm also a journalist, a CBC broadcaster.
I've been a music nerd since I was, 10 years old. Both my parents are in music or in arts. And I've been buying actively music since I was about 12 years old. Started DJing at 20. Started a website called Music Is My Sanctuary 7 years ago. Nine years ago. And started a side project called 24 Hours of Vinyl 4 years ago.
Ça fait longtemps que je suis dans tout ce qui est le hip-hop, suivre la musique, le mouvement et tout. J'ai aussi fait partie du groupe Tactical Crew depuis fin 90.
First step, you have to understand something. I'm an old schooler, so anything that was about music, I was touching. So my dad, before having those tape cassettes. Let me show you. Those tape cassettes. Before having that, right? You had the A-tracks. So I was busting the A-tracks first in his car. And we had this radio in the living room, A-tracks. And then, of course, with technology, just like the kids right now with CDs and USBs and stuff like that, and I would say MP3s and all that. Well, now I had to convert from 8-tracks to the tapes. So first tape, I can't tell you what it was, but I can tell you this much though. I was already clever to take blank tapes or take tapes from my parents and tape over them. And I would do my own mixtape, which at the time, you couldn't say that it was a mixtape because it was just a bunch of music that you put back to back to back. 60 minutes, 90 minutes, if you were lucky enough, 120. And you would put all those songs back to back and you would create your own playlist, if you want to put it this way.
Yeah, so the first time I got a tape cassette, I was in New York, in Brooklyn, on Flatbush, because that's where we used to go to buy cassettes for hip-hop music anyways, back in those days, which was the 80s. I was most likely, about 10 years old. I was in New York. We'd go at least twice a month for weekends and stuff like that. We have family in the States, family in New York. So while my mom was like buying, curtains on sale at some sort of store in Kings Plaza, they used to have tons of people selling cassettes just on the sidewalk and selling them like on tables with briefcases. And my first cassette was Queen Latifah, Ladies First. And yeah, I copped that in Brooklyn on Flatbush Ave. 1980, I'm not gonna say.
I think my first tape was the Do the Right Thing soundtrack with the Fight the Power song, Public Enemy. I think that's what I remember it. And it felt, you know, it felt dangerous. Like it felt like you weren't supposed to have it, and it felt like, I don't know, this music is yours, and it's not like, it's not necessarily your parents, but it felt like it's, yeah, almost like an act of defiance to buy it, you know.
Parler de hip-hop, puisqu'on est dans le thème, je me rappelle de mon premier mixtape de rap québécois, DJ Rec, le mixtape qui était en fait deux copies, deux cassettes, un tape anglophone, un tape francophone. Selon moi, c'est un des meilleurs mixtapes de rap québécois qui a été produit au Québec.
Moi, de mon côté, c'était au niveau du hip-hop aussi, c'était drôle parce que dans le fond, j'étais chez un de mes amis à Drummondville, puis il y avait une couple de cassettes de rap américain, des trucs comme ça. Dans ces cassettes-là, il y avait une cassette qui était marquée Jabber. Là, je me rappelais que le DJ de Traumaturge dans le temps, c'était DJ Jabber, qui était aussi avec DJ Naez, DJ Toast Dog aujourd'hui. Fait que c'est ça, j'ai réussi à échapper sa mixtape. Ça aussi, c'est une mixtape de rap québécois qui enveloppe beaucoup d'MC de la scène montréalaise du temps. Ça date de peu près au début des années 2000, à peu près peut-être. Des classiques là-dessus aussi.
Première cassette vraiment, parce qu'on a toujours eu des cassettes, c'était des cassettes ou des vinyles. Ma première cassette vraiment que j'ai eue, c'est Michael Jackson, Thriller. En ce temps-là, c'était l'album, et en même temps, c'était tout ce qui était le début hip-hop qu'on apprenait à connaître, mais il y avait Michael Jackson, fait que c'était ça la première cassette vraiment que j'ai payée, mettons, que j'ai achetée.
Oh man, I would say the most frustrating thing is when at one point your tape player decides to not cooperate, and then you're listening to your thing, and then at one point you hear that tape that's getting jammed. It's like it's getting stuck, and then you're like, oh no, man, and you have to take the tape out. And at that point, especially when that happens to one of your favorite tapes, then you become a surgeon. Because if you cut it or something happened, I would just slice it up on both sides, put a little tape, you know, those, that scotch tape, bing bang, and it would be brand new. So yes, you're missing a part, but you still have the majority of your tape intact. That would be the most frustrating thing, man. I became a surgeon. I didn't know I had it in me, man. I became a surgeon, man. Just to save the tape. Save the tape! But it was cool.
D'abord, qu'à un moment donné, ça finit. Vraiment, la seule chose, ça serait que... D'habitude, c'est à l'extérieur que je l'utilise, les cassettes, puis c'est avec les radios, ben, les batteries. C'est plus les batteries dans les cassettes, pour les cassettes. Ça utilise beaucoup l'énergie, fait qu'il faut aller acheter des batteries. Fait quand on chillait dans le parc ou quoi que ce soit, bon, ben, il faut 10 batteries pour ces radios-là. 10D, fait que là, il fallait voir. Quand tout le monde était bien chill, tout le monde pratique, quand ça commençait à faire défaut, tout le monde, je m'en vais manger ou nanana. Il fallait mettre l'argent pour acheter des batteries puis pas des cheap.
I was talking about the frustrating stuff about owning a tape cassette with my best friend, because she's got tape cassettes too. So she said right away, rewinding them is the most frustrating thing. And I remember having to rewind them with, like, you used to use a pen or a pencil to rewind them. Because sometimes you had a cassette player that didn't have a rewind button. It just had play and fast forward. So we'd have to rewind them with a pencil.
Fait qu'on mettait un crayon HB qui est assez comme soit les petits, je sais pas comment dire, le diagonal, quelque chose de même. Boom. Puis là, on le voit.
It's really annoying to skip songs. And for me, I'm a DJ, so I love to skip songs, and I love to constantly, like, be sort of like, you know, always thinking of what to play next, and oh, it's, I like that record because of those two songs. But what I love from tapes is it's sort of like, it's so frustrating to skip songs that you end up not doing it, and you end up discovering songs on the record that you weren't attracted to at first. So it's sort of the nice side and the bad side. And then of course the bad side is, like, you know, the whole tape jamming in your Walkman and getting out the pencil, and sometimes the tape gets so bad that you have to cut it and take two tiny pieces of scotch tape and do like an actual tape edit, ghetto style.
There was one technique. This, as you can see, is a ugly ass tape. I don't know. I put some liquid paper on it. try to write some shit on it. It says Salt and Pepper. There you go. So I probably, you know, copied an album on it. But anyways, if I went to rewind something real quick, I would take like a pen and just put it like this and then just turn it. Like it's a toy. Yeah, real quick, and then boom, just put it back, you know.
Mais t'attendais, chacun son tour fallait le faire. Boom, 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 pack, ça arrive à la fin, mais ça prenait un petit bout quand même.
Wu-Tang 36 Chamber, and yo, when that shit came out, man, it was like a religion, man. This tape, and then, that was my joint, that was my thing.
Probably some like mixtape cassettes that I'd get, either taping like Hot 97 when I was in New York, like recording them with like two ghetto blasters at the same time, trying to record off of the radio show.
I really remember the tape that had the most profound impact on me was a tape that my older cousin lent to me. Not the original tape, but like a dubbed version of it with, you know, bad handwriting on it, but definitely Low End Theory is a tape that, you know, I listen to. I know every single millisecond of that record inside and out. So
le que j'ai écouté le plus, il y a eu beaucoup, mais mettons celle vraiment là que de A à Z, que je sais là quand je la sortais des radios de Walkman que c'était chaud là, c'est vraiment la de Low End Theory de Charcoal Quest. C'était juste, je pense que c'était l'album parfait pour l'écouter dans le sens que c'est comme une histoire de A à Z.
Of course, you know, what I think is the magic of every single format is the booklet and the information that came with it. You know, when you were a kid, you were reading all of the shout outs and trying to make out like, oh, they're shouting out, I don't know, like whatever, Bismarcky. You know, there was no internet back then, so that was sort of the discogs of the eras. You tried to maybe look at which samples were declared in the booklet, look at who was shouting out who, and yeah, rest in peace, Fife.
Well, listen, my man, there's a lot of stuff. You see that Wu-Tang Boot Camp click mixtape that I've done in 97. It's not something that I put on digital. So if I want to go back to it, you know, I could. I probably will, or I don't remember. I just know that we worked so hard to put it out at that time. And there's a lot of memories too. That was back then with my clique called Cynics, CYNICS. We were putting mixtape at a time. As you can see, that was a 97 tape. So, vintage. Next year, we'll be celebrating 20 years. Yes, brother.
I still have my tape, some of my tape cassettes for sure. And I kept them regardless of the change in technology from CD to MP3 to streaming and all that stuff. I kept them because of nostalgia. I kept them for memories. I mean, I also had a lot of R&B stuff on tape. So I had like New Edition, 112 and Bobby Brown and that kind of stuff. So I just kept those things, yeah, for memories of my youth and an era in music that really shaped my interest in music and what I listen to. So yeah, just for the love of it, yeah.
Ben, c'est sûr que c'est pourquoi j'ai gardé, la raison première pourquoi j'ai gardé, parce que c'était pas, dans ce temps-là, c'était pas une collection, mais c'était juste mes cassettes. Chaque cassette, chaque premier album de ci, de ça, de tel groupe ou tel groupe, tu te rappelles où est-ce que tu étais, qu'est-ce que tu faisais, c'est comme des chapitres là, de ta vie. Tu arrives, le premier PE, Public Enemy, là, ah shit, t'es arrivé telle affaire, on faisait ci, on faisait ça, telle chose. Fait que c'est comme, toutes les cassettes sont comme un chapitre. C'est sûr que fin 80s jusqu'à milieu 90s, c'était ça, là, ça marquait. Après ça, ça a changé, peut-être que j'achetais moins de musique, peut-être pour ça.
I think the first time I really touched hip-hop, musically, that was the first form of music that I was able to bring back to Montreal. That was exactly Tony Montana year when Scarface came out. That was 1983. And we just moved to a new house, me and the fam. And then, but for that Christmas, we went to New York. And then we went to New York, and then my cousins, they showed me how to do the break dance and the haircuts, even jewelry at that point, you know, those, yeah. Showed you how to break dance. You learn the dance routine. And then at one point, you need the soundtrack. And the only way, there was no CDs at that time. You had records, but records would be more expensive. So the best thing to do, and especially at that time, there was no Hot 97 or Power 105. So that music would come late at night. So you had to be ready, record your tapes from a certain time to a certain time. Yo, I would sleep on it. Oh my God, put a different tape in, boom, record. And then whenever you have those type of tapes, you know, nothing written on it, you know what I'm saying? Those were the tapes. We would just, you know, hustle and record all that those type of music. So I can't throw this away. You know, I can't. There's some Chuck Chill Out, there's some Red Alert in there, there's some Molly Mall. You know, there's a bunch of things that for me, that's like the Bible of hip hop. I can't throw this away. That's too personal for me to just throw away. Even though I know I'm not gonna listen to them like every day all day, but I have this attachment that I can't. It's like vinyl.
Je jouais une radio Under Pressure, puis boum, il y a quelqu'un qui me dit le son il est bon, là, comment ça se fait, qu'est-ce qui se passe. Je lui explique que c'est un tape, tout ça. Il dit mais le son il est bon, c'est pas comme. Ben, c'est ça, sur ton téléphone, t'écoutes ce que t'as downloadé. Là, on était dehors, puis il capotait, il comprenait pas comment ça se fait que le son était bon, c'est juste un ruban avec une tête. Puis... Fait que c'est, pour moi, c'est il y en a d'autres, ça va être les vinyles aussi, là. Mais c'est ça, ça n'a rien à voir avec tout ce que tu peux downloader.
I mean, I think over the years I've probably gotten rid of a few. They probably just got damaged. And in line with the technology changing, you just didn't have those. I have the technology to play those tape cassettes, but they're old, so they sound not so great. And I'm just not that person that's gonna go and transfer them, et cetera, et cetera. Because I probably have the same cassettes on CD at this point, and probably available on MP3 anyway. So.
Yeah. Well, actually, regrettably, I got rid of my cassettes. So when I got into the CD era, I just sold all my tapes because I didn't have money to just, you know, buy everything in double. So I sold everything I had. So slowly, over the past, I don't know, like 8 years, 6 years, I've been slowly buying back every single tape that meant something to me back then. And I'm sort of like, it's a full-on nostalgic thing. And I'm trying to sort of recreate this collection that I had when I was a kid. Obviously, not everything in there is something that I used to listen to when I was a teenager. Although my original idea was to sort of recreate my rap tapes growing up, obviously I was too young to listen to, you know, The Time and Prince and all of that stuff. So I didn't have them, but I don't know, like it's just like I love house music, I love jazz, I love, you know, 80s pop, electro, whatever. So whenever I see a Prince tape, you know, for $1 or $10, I think it's a sin to not get it. You know, it needs to be saved from that store. So yeah, I mean, I have quite a bit of Prince tapes, and I'm slowly starting to sort of rebuild, like, you know, all kinds of like interesting 80s stuff, like Talking Heads and I don't know, like Level 42, and you know, you need all the Sade tapes. You know, I have a tape player in the bathroom, so Sade is usually in the bathroom for baths and stuff.
Non, tu vois, ça fait partie des meubles chez nous, là, c'est comme le présentoir que j'ai, là, ils vont me suivre. Pense pas, là, ça va toujours rester avec moi et tout, ça va être c'est comme quelque chose que je vais léguer après, là. Les enfants ou quelqu'un que je sais qui est passionné là-dessus, ou à mon fils, quelque chose comme ça, mais c'est pas... Non, jamais débarrassé, là, vraiment gardé, j'ai ça, j'ai plein... À part les cassettes originales, j'ai des mixtapes aussi, là, d'autres époques qu'on voit pas, même des shows qu'il y a à sécurité maintenant, mais qu'on voit là, qui ont changé comme Masters at Work. Là. Fait que tu peux prendre une cassette que j'ai de Masters at Work 94, là, puis une 2016, là, écoutez, c'est pas, on dirait, c'est deux mondes différents. Là, fait que ça, c'est des choses à garder. Il faut garder ça.
Last words, you can catch me every Friday, la cassette. playing hip-hop. I call it old school rule with my man Mike Steven from Five Stars, which is the name of our clique. Big up to Soul P. And that's how we do it, man. My man Solid Soul. We do Oasis, house music. We did it for 5 years at Sound Dahomey. It's about to come back very strong. We're gonna throw some good parties for the summer and the rest of the year. That's about it. Your boy's gonna start pushing some stuff, some music eventually. Producing a lot of music also on a house tip, on a hip hop tip. Hopefully I can do a little song with my man Wally. That would be amazing. That's about it, man. Just again, for the love of the music, we're just trying to bring our side. So catch us, Five Stars, dope sounds.
Ce que je fais maintenant, je fais toujours partie un peu, je supporte la scène maintenant, je fais plus d'événements, je fais plus de la danse. Je suis toujours en contact avec les gens, la danse, les DJ, tout ça, toujours là. Souvent des gens connaissent peut-être moins l'histoire de ce qui s'est passé avant. Et on peut toujours discuter de ça, c'est toujours le fun de parler dans le temps, comment c'était, tu sais, pour les gens, mais bon.
These days, as always, you can always, you know, check me out on Music Is My Sanctuary. It's a great website, 9 years, you know, probably around 20 different collaborators, so the content is not coming from just me. I'm sort of the curator and editor. You can find me at, you know, local gigs in Montreal, always playing 3-4 times a month, different sort of stuff all the time. I got the 24 Hours of Vinyl project that I do around the world, maybe 3-4 times a year. Also, you know, collecting this music, enjoying this music, which I think is record enjoying over record collecting, I think is better. And sell me your tapes.
Well, right now I think I'm being super inspired by new music that's out there, vibing off of people like Anderson .Paak and Hiatus Coyote, one of my favorite groups, but then also Emily King and King, We Are King, the trio. And it's interesting because those groups and those artists are definitely influenced by like some old school sounds. Like I'm listening to a track of Anderson .Paak and it's clear that he's like sampling Escape, which brings me back to like the tape cassette stuff, because I had Escape tape cassette, you know? So it's interesting how everything is cyclical, but that kind of inspiration is definitely helping me with writing my own material, my own music. So I'm working on that stuff while working on introducing my son to music, who loves to dance and loves to sing, and he's already writing his own songs. Like he's flipping the lyrics to ABC but using other words. So it's just wonderful to see how music is still influencing, continues to influence, you know, my life and my son's life and my family. So just enjoying music right now for what it is and trying to talk about it as much as I can when I get an opportunity. I think that's the last word.